And I just wonder whether HNA has given you any indication whatsoever what will it will do when that lockup expires next year.
No, they haven't, John. And by the way, thanks for having me on. As you might imagine, we're well aware of the news on the decision that they made as it relates to Park and the agreement that they've made with Park. As you pointed out in your introduction, we have a shareholder agreement that guides the relationship we have with HNA, and we don't comment on any of our shareholders' holdings, HNA or otherwise.
Well, Christopher, I just wonder how you respectfully communicate to the rest of the investor base when your largest investor is HNA with a sizable stake of your company. What can you say to the investor base then? Nothing?
Well, I mean, I can't say anything right now other than, as I said, we have a shareholder agreement that governs the relationship we have with them. What I can tell them is that everything continues to go exceptionally well at the company. You know, what we're seeing with broader economic growth, I think, gives us reason to be more optimistic about what's going to happen from a same store growth point of view this year. We continue to lead the market in unit growth with more rooms under construction than any other hospitality company on earth that's going to add to that. We expect to, again, produce a huge amount of free cash flow this year that we intend to aggressively return to our shareholders. And so everything in terms of what's going on with the fundamentals of the industry and specifically what's going on at Hilton, I'd say, is quite good and lots of reasons to be optimistic. What ultimately HNA does is up to HNA and, as I say, governed by our shareholder agreement.
So, Christopher, you don't see this as a cloud of uncertainty sort of above the company for the next year, say, until that lockup expires?
Well, I mean, of course it creates some uncertainty, and it's been a question that we've had from lots of investors, as you might imagine. Not every investor, but lots of investors. And so, again, I can't really comment on it other than to say it will eventually resolve itself. And in the interim, it does create a little bit of uncertainty, and there's not a whole heck of a lot that I can do about it.
Well, Christopher, at the moment, there's a lot of uncertainty on the international stage that I assume you can't do much about either. You yourself, the stats are amazing for Hilton. 1 in 5 hotel rooms under construction. They are tied to the Hilton brand worldwide. How uncertain is it as a CEO to really plan for that kind of expansion when we see these kind of tensions between not just China and the United States over the last week or so, but China and allies, China and Europe, the likes of the United States and allies, the U.S. and Europe, U.S. Japan, U.S. Canada?
Yeah, it's an important question. I think in terms of the so-called, you know, trade wars that might or might not occur, I think it's early to know. This is all sort of late-breaking news over the weekend. My hope is that calmer heads are going to prevail, and this is all part of a complex negotiation. But in any event, you know, time will tell. The nice thing about our model, John, is that we're not investing our money in these various locations around the world. All of the hotels that you described, 1 in 5 hotels under construction in the world has a Hilton brand name on it. 100% of that is being done with third-party capital. It's with local owners in markets like here in Berlin, or you mentioned China. Wherever the case may be, it's really dependent on third-party capital. We do not invest in the real estate side. As you know, we spun out our real estate business a year ago. But even before that, all of our growth was really being driven by third-party capital investing in the real estate. And so in the various locations around the world, as I think is demonstrated by the robust nature of our pipeline and the growing pipeline that we have, people still have a lot of confidence in where things are in the world, even though there's a lot going on and there's a lot of rhetoric back and forth. I think underneath it all is broader growth in most places around the world and globally on a GDP basis getting a little bit better, not a little bit worse. So we'll have to see what all the latest machinations related to the trade issues play out for over the next days and months. But I'd say the underlying trend is quite good.
Is it quite good? And I'd ask you the following question, just politically speaking. Do you think you can reconcile the America First objectives of this administration with the goals of Hilton? Are those two things aligned?
Listen, I'm a well-chronicled believer in globalization. And so our business depends on interconnectivity across the globe, and we have been a huge beneficiary of that.
I'm not going to comment on America First. So, Christopher, does that put you at odds with this administration then? Presumably it does.
Excuse me?
Presumably that puts you at odds with this administration then.
Not necessarily. Again, everybody, you know, all administrations have sort of a different style of how they get things done. I think, you know, this administration is doing it in a way, I think, that is part of a complex negotiation. I think in the end, globalization is here to stay. I think it's going to be beneficial for our business. And I think notwithstanding America First as a starting point, I think America is going to ultimately be, over the long term, a responsible trading partner in the world for all of our major allies.
Christopher, before we lose you, as you sit in the heart of Europe in, say, Berlin, what is the argument for free trade and globalization at this point? As a multinational company that you lead, what's the argument for it?
I think the argument for it is ultimately it's going to give all the economies around the world incremental growth over time, and it's going to create incremental jobs around the world. The more that globalization takes hold in a sensible, constructive way, the more productivity you'll see in economies around the world, and the more jobs that you'll see around the world. Now, our business, you know, we're an incredible engine of both growth, but particularly of jobs. If you think about it, we represent 10% of global GDP in travel and tourism, and around 1 in 10 jobs as well is in the travel and tourism business. This is going to be a huge engine of jobs as we continue to find more and more ways to ease travel restrictions and allow people to cross borders in a more thoughtful way.